And Father, we do thank you so much for giving us your Son. And that if we would believe in him, that if we would trust in him, that if we would cling to him as the only Savior, that you would grant us eternal life to forever be spent with you. What an amazing thing that is. And I just pray, Lord, that all of us here that know you, that would just really be etched in our hearts, just like it would be stone. Otherwise, anyone here that doesn't know you, Jesus, I just pray that they would come to know you. They would come to know what it is like to know you, that they would have their names written in the book of life, to have true life, to have true love, departed from this world and granted eternal life. We say this in your holy name. Amen. Amen. Let's please turn your Bibles, open up your Bibles and turn to Deuteronomy chapter 15, verse 1. Deuteronomy chapter 15, verse 1. So while you guys are turning there, those of you that are watching on video, that watch us on YouTube, understand that inevitably we will be transitioning our YouTube teachings over to the platform Rumble. We will stay on YouTube as long as we can. It's a good place to preach the gospel and share it with others. But we've been dinged twice already, and third time will be coming soon. It's just inevitable. And so otherwise, you can find us on Rumble, and more of that to come. We will continue talking about that in the next few weeks. Otherwise, let's get into last week's review. Pastor Kevin did a great job on what it means to not look like the nations around you, to not look like those to the world around you. He spent a great deal of time on cutting, and there's nothing new under the sun. Solomon tells us that in Ecclesiastes. There's nothing new under the sun. They were doing it then. They do it now. Oftentimes, you'll find teenagers depressed and just in despair, and not just teenagers, predominantly teenagers, but anyone really. And they say that they find relief in cutting themselves. They find relief in it. And it really is just a very demonic thing. And this is not the way that our God would have us be. Not at all. Then it says, you are the children of the Lord your God. You shall not cut yourselves. Very specific requirement there. Israel was God's witness people. They were to look altogether different from the nations around them, from the pagan nations that surrounded them. Same thing for us, the church. We are to look altogether different from the world. And too often, we try to look like the world. Too often, we want to look like the world. We want to fit in. They wanted a king, Saul. They wanted to look like the rest of the world, constantly wanting to look like the rest of the world. And Israel were God's chosen people. They were God's witness people. And we, the church, are now God's witness people. And we're not to look like the world. We are to look starkly different from the world. Talked about the dietary law, clean and unclean meats. That was really to preserve the nation of Israel, health, disease. They didn't have the things that we have now. They didn't know the things that we know now. And so God wanted them to obey that law because he really wanted to preserve the nation. It was imperative that the nation of Israel was preserved. And not only preserved, but that they prevailed also, because they are God's witness people. We don't necessarily abide by this law anymore. More power to you if you want to. You know, nobody's going to look at you funny. I like eating pig. I like eating shellfish, you know. I haven't got sick from it yet, but all that was done away in the New Testament. All that was done away in the New Covenant. And so, you know, eat your heart out. Tithing, we also talked about tithing last week. This law was given so that the Jews could properly give back to the function of the temple, all right? It was given to the Levite, the priest that took care of the temple, to the Word of God and to the rest of the nation so that their needs were properly taken care of. That's exactly what happens today. Except it's not a 10% rule anymore. Now what does the Lord want you to do? He wants you to give with a cheerful heart. That's all that He really requires of you. If you don't have a cheerful heart, you don't give. But if you have a cheerful heart and you want to give to the functions of the church and the leadership and everything else, then please give with a cheerful heart. That is what Jesus would want you to do. Also in that tithing law, it was a welfare system for the stranger, the fatherless, the widow. That is how the Lord would want us to be. And we're going to really see that as we go in today's study about taking care of our brother in need. It's imperative. God has a compassionate heart. He's full of compassion. You're going to see that in this study today. And we're to have the heart of God. As we transform in our walk, we're to have the heart of God. And so God's compassionate. He wants us to be compassionate. But He wants us, God's full of wisdom. He wants us to be full of wisdom. And so when we have a compassionate heart towards others, it's to be done in wisdom, not as the world would do it. All right? And so with that, Deuteronomy chapter 15, verse 1, it says this: At the end of every 7 years, you shall grant a release of debts. And this is the form of the release. Every creditor who has lent anything to his neighbor shall release it. He shall not require it of his neighbor or his brother, because it is called the Lord's release. Now this, it's a commandment given to Israel that is far different from what we would do today, from what we understand today. But as we go through this, we're really going to see the wisdom in God's commandment here and how it's a stopgap for the creditor and it's a stopgap for the person receiving, the person in need. You're going to see all of God's wisdom as we go through this. In Hebrew, this seven-year release is called, if I pronounce Shemitzah, if I pronounce that correctly, I think it's called Shemitzah. And this Lord's release was on a seven-year cycle, and it was done on the calendar, okay? So you can mark it down on the calendar. In other words, it didn't begin, if two people entered into a contract, that seven-year release didn't start and end with their own contract. It started and ended on the calendar. So if you went into this at year four, you had 3 years. If you went into it year two, you had five more years to go. Deciding to lend to your brother was an obligation, but it was based on discretion, all right? It was based on discretion of the lender. However, once the lender did enter into this, he was then required to honor the Lord's release. So once you stepped into this thing, once you used discretion and wanted and helped your brother in need based on a moral credit check, once you entered into that, then you were required to honor the Lord's release. And you'll hear me use that term a few times today, a moral credit check. Because what does a bank do these days? They don't care about your morality. They just want to make sure you got a job. They want to make sure that you can pay it back. And they want to make sure you can pay it back with interest. Interest, something that the Lord does not require, and He's very much against. You're going to see that too. No, under God's commandment, it's a moral credit check, and that is how discretion is used. But sadly, even banks today will pretty much lend to anyone with. You don't even have to have a job; just have a beating heart, I guess. So if a person in need checked all the boxes, then the brother who was able to lend and help the brother in need, and he was comfortable in doing this, he was then obligated to do that. We'll talk about this more as we go on, but just think of this. Remember in the book of Ruth, when next of kin, he had the opportunity to take Ruth, as his wife. Right? And he decided not to do it. And so then that left Boaz next of kin, and he did it. Now, you got the spitting, and you got the sandal, and you got, so they're scoffing at the other gentleman. And so there was a community national expectation to get this done. But at the end of the day, he didn't have to do it based on whatever he had going on. And he didn't want to do it because it was going to ruin his own inheritance. And so then Boaz, we don't really know the details about that necessarily. One would think that he was being selfish in that. But nonetheless, through God's providence, it left the opportunity for Boaz to take Ruth in. So it's kind of like that. That's kind of the example that in principally speaking, that's what this year of release is like. Every Israelite who was wealthy was a potential provider of funds. All right. In God's law, there were no banks. There were no banks, and there was especially no interest because that was called usury. All right. But every wealthy Israelite was a potential provider of funds. And this is really for folks who suffered hardships, okay? Again, without interest. This is key because no usury is allowed in the Lord's commandment here. None at all. And as we go through this, we'll dip over into Nehemiah and see what a nation looks like when they ignore this law. So let's talk about some examples that this might look like. Back then, your neighbor's one and only ox died and he couldn't plow the field, all right? They were on a cycle, they were on a seasonal cycle. They have to get their field plowed. They only have one ox. They don't have 10 like some others may have. And something happened to that ox. He broke a leg, he died, something may happen. Well, he's got to get his field plowed. So as long as he's morally credible, then a Israelite who is wealthy or well off can lend him the money, lend him an ox, get it figured out, and then he's going to be in debt. So that whatever that debt looks like for that 7 years or three or four, wherever they're at in the calendar, and so the wealthy Israelite would be obligated to do that. Another one is your elderly neighbor's children came down with severe illness during harvest time and he didn't have anyone to reap the fields and needed to hire help but didn't have any money. That probably happened quite often. You know, people got sick. You know, if you were older and you couldn't be out there plowing the fields or harvesting and all your kids came down with severe illness or something like that, you're going to need help, all right? So in this structure, in God's commandment, it provided a way for those folks to be taken care of. Maybe their house accidentally burned down, all right? That's a major, major hardship. What does it look like for us today? You know, something simple, going down the road, somebody's pulled over on the side of the road and they're jumping up and down like this. You know, this is your fellow brother, it's your fellow American, right? And how many of you guys are just gonna drive by? You don't have to raise your hand. The problem is, we're always paranoid, and you always wonder if something nefarious is afoot. I'll tell you what, there's a lot of other countries that I've been to I wouldn't pull over if somebody was on the side of the road. But I digress. But are you going to expect that person to pay you back? Not necessarily. You know, you don't even know them. They're your brother, they're your neighbor, but you may not know them, all right? But if you're there to lend them a helping hand, you're kind of obligated to do that with a cheerful heart, all right? Every 7 years, the debt was canceled so that your brother wouldn't get bogged down in debt and so that the lender stayed clear of the temptation of usury. These are the stopgaps, all right? This 7-year release is a stopgap for both parties, so that the person receiving wasn't bogged down in debt, which is what we'll take a look at in Nehemiah here soon. And it also provided a stopgap for the person that was lending the money, lending the funds, lending the help, so that they weren't tempted into usury, so that they weren't tempted into enslaving them. There's great, great wisdom in this. If this law was followed properly, it wouldn't allow for what? Oligarchs? It wouldn't allow for multi-billionaires to enslave the poor. Principally speaking, do we see a direct 180 from this standard in our own country, in our own world? Absolutely. Absolutely. And it's only going to get worse. Corporations, world banks, Amazon. The world has no shortage of oligarchs and billionaires who enslave the poor. And they do it to fill that never-ending bucket of greed. All right, so that stopgap's not there in our world, and we suffer from it. The poor and the masses are enslaved to them, and the rich become enslaved by their sinful greed. Now, I do need to make mention, not all rich people are this way. There's a lot of rich people out there that are very well off that are not this way. But we do live in a fallen world, and the world has provided a way for these folks to be tempted into this way of life. And if they don't have the Lord in their life, I wouldn't even say morality, you know. If they don't have the Lord in their life, if they don't know the God of the Bible, it's almost a given that they're going to be that way. Every bank that you know of charges interest, and this was not allowed in God's law. Interest, taxation, and usury was not allowed in God's law. It really, really is sweet. Verse 3, of a foreigner you may require it, but you shall give up your claim to what is owed by your brother. So this law, the Lord's release, only applied to your Jewish brother. It did not apply to the foreigner. So last week when we were reading, let's see, it was chapter 4, verse 21. I'll just read it to you. This was concerning clean and unclean meat, kosher foods. You shall not eat anything that dies of itself. You may give it to the alien who is within your gates, that he may eat it, or you may sell it to a foreigner, for you are a holy people to the Lord your God. Now, the key text here is that Israel were to be a holy people, all right? They're special. They're set apart. They're God's holy people. They're God's witness people. They were to prevail, all right? That's a key word there. They were to prevail among the nations. And it does show a stark contrast to the pagan nations around them. So, you know, on its face, it does sound a bit hypocritical. It's like, you know, I don't want you guys eating that dead animal, but you can go ahead and sell it to the foreigner, all right? Where we're at here, you know, you guys aren't going to impose tax and usury on one another. You guys will obey the Lord's release here, but you don't have to with the foreigner. The difference there is that God's people are chosen, they're a witness, and they are to prevail among the nations around them, all right? So let me read that again to you. Verse 3, of a foreigner you may require it, but you shall give up your claim to what is owed by your brother. So understand, under God's law, the Israelites were not allowed to search out, kidnap, and enslave a foreigner. All right. So this verse, this teaching, this passage, and many others like it were used by colonialists to go out and enslave the poor. They were to go out and kidnap other folks, and they did it for a long, long time. The world did that. Every generation, every culture went and kidnapped slaves for them, for their country, for their nation. It's so, so important for us to understand that this was not allowed in God's law. It was not allowed in God's law. The foreigner was more than willing, and wanted to come to Israel to assimilate with the Jewish people. All right? I cannot stress this enough. Under God's law, any Israelite, any Jewish person, they were not allowed to go out to another nation and kidnap and enslave anyone else. Completely forbidden. What this law is for any foreigner that wants to come to the nation of Israel, for any stranger that wants to come in and assimilate with the Jewish people, because they want to serve the true and living God, because they want to enjoy the things that the God of Israel allows Israel to enjoy. Trust me, they're sitting afar off. They're in other nations. They can see what's going on in Israel. And they're all talking about, can you believe that what their God allows them to do? Can you believe the commandments that their God commands them to do? What a beautiful thing. I want to go be part of them. I want to be with them. They enjoyed so many benefits, as many Israelites did. Not all of them, but so many of them. This was provided for them by way of God's law. Imagine being a slave in a foreign land and hearing the stories of how the God of Israel commanded Israel to treat their servants. Right? Imagine being a slave in a foreign land. Trust me, they didn't get a day off a week. They didn't get a day off a week, but if they were able to escape that foreign land and enter into the nation of Israel, I mean, they got a day off a week to enter into the Sabbath, and so many other fringe benefits they were able to enjoy. Just as God wants the Gentiles to be among his flock now, he wanted the foreigner to be among his flock then, all right? God wants all people to come to him, not just the Jew, but everyone, the Gentile. He wanted it then, and he wants it now. This is compassion. This is truly compassion. Verse 4, except when there may be no poor among you, for the Lord will greatly bless you in the land which the Lord your God is giving you to possess as an inheritance. Here's the kicker. Only if you carefully obey the voice of the Lord your God to observe with care all these commandments, which I command you today. For the Lord your God will bless you just as he promised you. You shall lend to many nations, but you shall not borrow. You shall reign over many nations, but they shall not reign over you. Wow. I got to read that again. Verse 5. Only if you carefully obey the voice of the Lord your God to observe with care all these commandments. It applies to them then. It applies to us now, you guys. Individually, nationally, in a church, if we observe and obey what the Lord would have us obey, we are going to prosper from that. It doesn't mean that hardships aren't going to come. We're seeing that now. Hardships will come. We live in a fallen world. They're inevitable. But the more we live by God's law, the more we live under his reign, the more that we pay attention to how he would have us be, loving, compassionate, never at the expense of the truth, we're going to prosper from that. And it really is sad that not only does the world not see that, but sometimes us in our walks, we forget that too. So it's always important for us to go back to the basics and understand that if we were to do that, then we would prosper. Think about our very own nation. Again, our nation, the great U.S. of A., it's not without its issues, and it's always had issues. It's always had sin in the camp. But for so often, especially in the beginning, you know, every one of you have heard the Judeo-Christian ethic, the Judeo-Christian values. For a long, long time, our nation, they didn't ignore God like they do now. They paid attention to his commandments. They paid attention to the Ten Commandments. Jesus was on the lips of folks, you know, whether they knew him or not, whether they were born again or not. Jesus was understood by so many, and God reigned over our nation in such a large way, in such a beautiful way. And we prospered from that. This nation really prospered from that. It says right here, lend to many nations, but you shall not borrow. Our currency is the currency that even now, it holds the reserve for the world, all right? It's the standard that is set across the globe. That's quickly going away. Why is it quickly going away? Why are all those benefits? Why are all those blessings going away? That's right, sin. Because we ignore God. And when you ignore God, it's not that you just ignore God, but when you do ignore God, all that junk creeps in, all that sin creeps in, all that wickedness creeps in, and then the people love it so, and then you're well on your way. And it's really, really sad. Read the book of Judges, and you'll get You'll get that six times over. Sustained poverty is a direct result of disobeying God's law. And I use the term sustained, all right? Jesus said the poor will always be with us. There's always going to be poverty. But principally speaking, generally speaking, as far as a nation goes, sustained poverty is a direct result of disobeying God's law. If a nation paid attention to God's law, there would be much less poverty. Again, hardships will occur, and that's exactly why God's providing this text now. Principally speaking, to the general population, whether individually, nationally, sustained poverty is a result of ignoring God. Why? Because we're doing it man's way. We're doing it which seems right in a man's own eyes. Excuse me there. And Solomon has a lot to say about that. So let's just go through some of the things here that we spend money on. Why is our nation in poverty? Why is our nation fast becoming, entering into poverty? Well, for one, we're well outside of God's law. We're well outside of the way that God would have us be as a people, as a nation, collectively speaking. I understand there's pockets. I understand there's churches. You know, there's folks like us that we want God to reign. But principally speaking, generally speaking, it's not that way in our nation. We see it plain as day. So lifestyles that are in direct violation of God's law. And, and that's a category in itself. The lifestyles of people. Direct violation of God's law. You spend a lot of money on that. How about STDs and healthcare? Sexually transmitted diseases and healthcare. I mean, I didn't look it up, but it's in the billions and billions of dollars that we spend annually. Annually we spend that in this nation. Pastor Kevin says this a lot, and it is true. If you really think about it, if we were to obey God and His law concerning marriage and concerning sexual immorality, in two generations, we wouldn't have one STD, not even one. Two generations is all it would take. We all know that's not going to happen, but it still is interesting to understand that. Drugs and alcohol, all right? This is a lifestyle that we spend a lot of money on. Rehabilitation centers, and all this falls under our healthcare system. We spend so much money on this stuff, you guys. So much money on it. And we used to spend a lot of money rehabilitating. Now we spend money on giving everybody drugs. And so we kind of flipped the script there, but nonetheless, there's a lot of money going out. And here's the kicker, you guys are going to see this increasing more and more. Now our nation, through our healthcare system, is spending a ton of money on gender transitioning for the kids. Can you say lightning bolts? I mean, think about it, you guys. I really do meditate on this. I mean, think about what we are doing to our children, little tiny children. When you meditate on that, you start to even just begin to understand the patience, the long-suffering of God, because He wants all to come to Him. The mercy that He bestows upon the world, the nations, it really is. I mean, what we're doing to our children deserves lightning bolts like that. But He's long-suffering, it's a good thing most of us aren't God, right? Oh, Lord, help us. Lord, help us. Help our children. It's so sad. Jails, prison systems, courts, justice system, etc. How much money do we spend there? I mean, billions and billions and billions of dollars. And I want you guys to keep in mind, nowhere in God's Mosaic law did it allow for institutions of incarceration. Not once. There's no prisons, there's no jails. The closest thing you ever get to it is a quarantine for the leper. All right? And that's not for, criminal punishment. The way that God would have it, there's corporate punishment, back in these days, execution. But I'm sure many prisoners and inmates would rather take a public beating once than spend months and years in prison. All right? I know I would. I know that not everybody knows my testimony, but I went to prison 5 different times when I was younger, in my younger years. 5 times I went to prison, spent many years there, in and out, in and out, in and out, a lot of drugs and alcohol. The list goes on. I would have much rather taken a public beating in the town square than spend all that time in prison. School systems for our kids, colleges, universities. At one point in time, all of our hospitals and universities, remember I said Judeo-Christian ethic value, these were all Christians that instituted these. All of your major universities were once Christian, put together and instituted by Christian men and women. They've all become corrupt. They've all become corrupt. For a long time now, I have not advocated for any of my children to go to university. Why would I spend, and it would be me, not them, why would I spend, $60,000-$80,000, go in major debt to send them to a place where they get God is questioned constantly, where they get taught that God doesn't exist, where they get taught that the world is what should be prevailing, with sin, wickedness, corruption. Why would you spend your money on that? And that's just me. It's just my opinion. I know that a lot of children have went to college and university and they've came out okay. But again, generally speaking, it's the devil's playground, and I've always advocated for trade work, go in there, make money while you're working, you don't go in debt, and you make a lot more money than all those folks that went to university, that's for sure. Unfair tax systems heaped on the backs of the people by corrupt governments, oh boy. We live in a state here where we pay a lot of taxes for a lot of things, and a lot of these taxes just end, who knows where they end up, in those never-ending buckets of greed that I told you about. They end up in the pockets of all these corrupt politicians, and it's just horrible. Again, there were no usury in God's law, all right? No taxation, no usury. That's why when Jesus walked, the Pharisees thought they were going to get him. Who should we give? Should we give to Caesar? And he said, "Give to Caesar what is Caesar, and give to God what is God's." And even though there was none of that in God's law, we live here now, and we are to obey the tax system. All the while knowing that we have a citizenship in heaven where all that will be done away with. This place, this time is the blink of an eye, and it's going to go away real quick. So, as we're learning through Moses' pleas, if we would quit fighting God and do it his way, we would miss so much trouble and turmoil. We truly would be blessed if we would just stop and do it God's way and not what we deemed right in our own eyes. Verse 7, if there is among you a poor man of your brethren within any of the gates in your land, which is the Lord your God, which the Lord your God is giving you, you shall not harden your heart nor shut your hand from your poor brother, but you shall open your hand wide to him and willingly lend him sufficient for his need, whatever he needs. Beware lest there be a wicked thought into your heart, saying, the 7th year, the year of release, is at hand, and your eye be evil against your poor brother, and you give him nothing, and he cry out to the Lord against you, and it becomes sin among you. Again, the lending man had discretion in the expectation and obligation of lending to those who were poor and in need, who had a hardship. There was discretion there. Did this mandate a wealthy Israelite give to a person who suffered from being involved in witchcraft and sorcery, which in today's age would be drug use? No. He's giving that moral credit check, all right? Under that law, they would have been executed for that. They would have been executed for witchcraft and sorcery. Did this obligate the wealthy and prosperous to give to the young men who were only poor because they were lazy and couldn't get out of their bedroom because they can't get off their video games? The world triggers me. I can't step outside of my bedroom because I'm gaming. No. This is a serious offense. You're dishonoring your mother and your father by doing that. All right? That would have been handled that way. Did this apply to a man who may have lost everything due to a divorce because he committed adultery on his wife many times over? All right? He's down and out. No, he would have been stoned for that too. So in God's law, all those things would have been dealt with another way. All right? Now, we don't live that way today. And we do have a heart of compassion, all right? If one of our children ends up in all given over to drugs and alcohol, we don't take them out and stone them, all right? I'm thankful for that. And I know that many of you are too. I know a lot of you, and a lot of us a lot of us have had to deal with all that, and I'm thankful for the church and the men and women who came alongside me during those times, and they showed great compassion on me as the Lord would have them do. And they helped me, and they helped me, and they helped me. Not every time, because, you know, sometimes you got to get to a point where you got to let them fall, all right? Then it becomes ridiculous to keep helping them. When they're just going to run off and get high again. So we really do have to use discretion, but nonetheless, the Lord really does want us to have compassion on those around us. It's important, again, to understand that this is mainly for unexpected hardships, okay? If it fit the criteria, you'd be expected to help and give. You're expected to help your fellow man, woman, family, neighbor, whoever it is among you, whoever it is that might be in need. You were expected to help, and you're expected to help fairly, okay? So please turn to Nehemiah chapter 5. Nehemiah chapter 5, verse 1. We're going to see a great biblical example of what it looks like when the Israelites ignored this law. As you know, many of you know, Nehemiah was well after Moses' day. The Jews have already returned to Jerusalem from their 70-year exile in Babylon, so it's well after Moses. However, they are having a really tough time getting the temple built. They're having a tough time getting the city built. They're having a tough time getting the walls built. They're having a tough time getting their lives squared away, is what they're doing. They're just having a tough time here. And Nehemiah knows that. And that's why he's here, because he has compassion. He has compassion for his brethren. That's why Nehemiah is here. So what I'm going to do for you is I'm going to read right through verses 1 through 13, okay? So Nehemiah chapter 5, verses 1 through 13. And there was a great outcry of the people and their wives against their Jewish brethren, for there were those who said, "We are sons and our daughters are many. Therefore, let us get grain that we may eat and live." There were also some who said, "We have mortgaged our lands and vineyards and houses that we might buy grain because of the famine." There were also those who said, "We have borrowed money for the king's tax on our lands and vineyards. Yet now our flesh is as the flesh of our brethren, our children as their children, and indeed we are forcing our sons and our daughters to be slaves, and some of our daughters have been brought into slavery. It is not in our power to redeem them, for other men have our lands and vineyards." And then this is Nehemiah speaking. "And I became very angry when I heard their outcry in these words. After serious thought," and remember, Nehemiah is a praying man. He never acts without serious contemplation, thought, and prayer. "After serious thought, I rebuked the nobles and rulers and said to them, 'Each of you is exacting usury from his brother.'" He's remembering this law, all right? "So I called a great assembly against them, and I said to them, According to our ability, we have redeemed our Jewish brethren who were sold to the nations. Now, indeed, will you even sell your brethren, or should they be sold to us? Then they were silenced and found nothing to say. Then I said, "What are you doing? What you are doing is not good. Should you not walk in the fear of our God because of the reproach of the nations, our enemies? I also, with my brethren and my servants, am lending them money and grain. Please, let us stop this usury. Restore now to them, even this day, their lands, their vineyards, their olive groves, and their houses. Also, a hundredth of the money of the grain, the new wine and the oil that you have charged them." So they said, and this is beautiful, you guys, they're going to repent. Imagine that. So they said, "We will restore it and will require nothing from them. We will do as you say." Then I called the priests and required an oath from them that they would do according to the promise. Then I shook out the fold of my garment and said, "So may God shake out each man from his house and from his property who does not perform this promise. Even thus may he be shaken out and emptied." And all the assembly said, "Amen," and "Praise the Lord." Then the people did according to this promise. Isn't that beautiful? Isn't that beautiful that they actually repented when Nehemiah gave them the why and what for? So what we just read there, that's a direct violation of God's law, exactly what we're studying today. All right, it's a great biblical example. The rich Jews are taking complete advantage of the poor Jews. All right, the sin of greed has overwhelmed them. They're oppressing them by usury. Their families had grown and they couldn't feed them. On top of that, there was a famine. All right, so they're having all these children. They can't feed them all. And so the wealthier Jews are looking at that saying, all right, here's a vantage point. I'm going to take advantage of this. Some Jews were implementing taxes too heavy to bear. So poor Jews couldn't have grain, nothing to eat. All their money went to taxes. Poor Jews had to borrow money just to pay the king's taxes. And the Jews who were better off were oppressing them with a heavy tax. So tax, 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 just kept taxing them, just major oppression. They got to the point where they had to sell their sons and daughters into slavery just to get by. The oppressive Jews made the burden so heavy the poor Jews couldn't redeem their own children. I mean, this is horrible. This is a horrible place to be. This is a horrible place for the nation of Israel to be. So thank God for Nehemiah. Thank God, because the priests, the nobles, the judges, the rulers, they're all in on this. And they're probably guiltier than most of them. But thankfully, Nehemiah came and stood his ground. He became angry. And this is a righteous anger, you guys. There is such thing as a righteous anger. He put an end to this usury. And I just got to make mention that Nehemiah is a clear picture of Jesus, okay? When we're bogged down in our sin, when we're bogged down in our wickedness, Jesus is there to restore us to a place of righteousness, exactly what Nehemiah did. Let's turn back to Deuteronomy 15, verse 10. Deuteronomy 15, 10. "You shall surely give to him, and your heart should not be grieved when you give to him. Because for this thing, the Lord your God will bless you in all your works and in all to which you put your hand. For the poor will never cease from the land. Therefore I command you, saying, you shall open your hand wide to your brother, to your poor, your needy, and in your land." For the poor will never cease from the land. Jesus repeated the same thing in the Gospels. You will always have the poor among you. We live in a fallen world, you guys. We will always have the poor with us. And so by his Spirit, I pray that we would have a compassionate heart to all those in need. God's people then were to have a wise and compassionate heart. Today, the church were to have a wise and compassionate heart. You know, if we are able to lend, if we are able to help to anyone with a hardship, to anyone in need, let us do that, but do it with wisdom. Do it with discretion. Okay, because the Lord wants us to be wise in what we're doing. We see this so clearly in so many events in the Gospels, all through the Gospels, all through Jesus' teachings. He's wanting and instructing us to help those who are poor and needy. We are to love the Lord God with all of our heart, mind, and soul, and our neighbor as ourself. Of course, that's always taken out of context, right? true love is full of rebuke. True love is full of correction. All right, a lot of people forget that today. I know that you parents out there, you understand that rebuking and correcting your children, it's done in love. We have to do it in love, and that's true love. Not to just let your kids go willy-nilly, you know, because you don't want to hurt their feelings. That's not true love. A wise thing my mother always told me was, growing up, she said, I'm not here to be your friend, I'm here to be your mother. I'll be your friend later. And I use that same phrase with my kids now. Verse 12, if your brother, a Hebrew man or a Hebrew woman, again, not a foreigner, is sold to you and serves you 6 years, then in the seventh year you shall let him go free from you. I can't quit saying this enough. The Lord put stop gaps in place for the slave, for the servant, for the master. These stop gaps ensure a quality of life for the servant. But those stop gaps are for the master too. It's a channel. The channel is removed. So he doesn't fall into the temptation of greed and oppressiveness. Again, great wisdom in God's law here. Verse 13, and when you send him away free from you, you shall not let him go away empty-handed. You shall supply him liberally from your flock, from your threshing floor, and from your winepress. From what the Lord has blessed you with, you shall give to him. You shall remember what you were, that you were a slave in the land of Egypt, and the Lord your God redeemed you. Therefore, I command you this thing today. The Lord's law is sweet. It really is sweet. If you served, you didn't get just dumped on the curb. The Lord commanded that the master give all kinds of provision, that he would give a monetary package to that person leaving his household to start a new life. This is provision. This is compassion. Verse 16, and if it happens that he says to you, I will not go away from you. This is so beautiful. And when I read this, you guys, I really want you to just think of Jesus as we're reading verses 16 and 17 here. Just, this is Jesus. And if it happens that he says to you, I will not go away from you because he loves you and your house, since he prospers with you, then you shall take an awl and thrust it through his ear to the door, and he shall be your servant forever. Also, to your female servant you shall do likewise. Before we come to Jesus, we are serving a master. And that master, whether you know it or not, has a collar around your neck and a chain attached to that collar. And you are serving him. You are serving the enemy of your soul, and you are serving the world. But you come to a realization, you hear the gospel, and you come to a realization of the truth, and you tell yourself, I don't want to be a slave to this master anymore. I'm tired of being a slave to this master. Jesus is there to thrust that all through your ear to that doorpost. Frank talked about the doorpost. You know, Jesus is in the business of doorposts. Frank talked about that doorpost in the first Passover. Jesus wants to thrust that all through the ear of everyone here. And I, if you don't know Jesus, please, please come to him. Please come to him. Please come and be a bondservant to the man, to the God-man who died for your sins, to make a way for you to come to heaven and be with him for all of eternity. Because once you get that all thrust through your ear on that doorpost, you are free. Free from wickedness, free from sin, free from the enemy that wants to enslave you. It truly is true freedom. To be a bondservant to Jesus Christ is true spiritual freedom. Not just now, but for eternity. Amen. Lord, we thank you so much. We thank you for your law, Lord. We thank you for the wisdom in your law. We thank you for the compassion in your law. Lord, you instruct us to be your witness. You instruct us to be set apart You instructed your chosen people then to be set apart, Lord, and you instruct us now as the church to be set apart. And Lord, you have made all the room in the world, all the room in the universe, all the room. You have made all the room for the foreigner, the stranger, to come to you. And we know that it is your heart for all of them to come to you. And I pray, Lord, that if there's anyone here, Lord, that has not come to you, that doesn't understand, who doesn't know the freedom that we have in Jesus, that they would do so now, Lord. Please, please draw them in. We say this in your holy, holy name. Amen. Holy God.